Ofer Gaber, you are director de recherche at CNRS, and you have been at the IHES in the early 1980s. Last month, on the 16th of May, you turned 60, and the IHES is organizing a conference in your honor next week to celebrate your birthday. And also, this is one of the four conferences for events celebrating 60th anniversary of the creation of the IHES by Mochan in 1958. So, Ofer, I will ask you a few questions about mostly mathematics and how you work in mathematics, you see them. And my first question is very simple. What is your first mathematical memory?
So maybe it was when I was a child, I was interested in elementary questions, but they were, I started things that from books that were not taught yet in school, and so I knew about, so I cannot probably date it, but I know that around age 9, 1967, there was a game that the students played about kind of drawing a figure on the in one line. So this is essentially the Euler's seven bridges problem, but it is for general things. I mean, you have some points and some lines connecting them, and you have it's connected, but you have to pass every to have one line that covers each segment once. So then this, so there is a criterion in terms of parity of the number of edges. So I found the proof of this, or I thought about it around age 9, and this was the first non-trivial thing that I can remember. Of course, I was interested in other things. I figured out like how to, like you, for example, you can exponentiate to fractional powers by taking roots, like, and then I imagined how to do it with reals by approximation. So I somehow figured out how to do some basic analysis or some. But when I was, I was in elementary school. Yeah. But later I attended actually when courses for talented children, so that I was taught things around age.
So that introduces my next question. During elementary school and middle school,
I was in middle school. How did you
learn mathematics? And is there a teacher or a person that you remember as especially interesting, influencing, inspiring?
But I now I cannot remember exactly, but there was when I was around 11, I met a professor from the United States called Professor Wernick, who was a distant relative of my family, and he asked me some questions. Maybe there was the game of Nim or something. Anyway, I could solve some certain problems, so he was quite enthusiastic, and he sent me several books for my bar mitzvah when I was around 13. I still have those books with some dedication. So I wrote to him letters about what I was interested in. And so I made some mistakes in English in the letters, but in any case, he sent me something about number theory and group theory, and he wrote a book on analytic geometry and other. And so I studied, like sometimes I talked with some, like the brother of the friends in school was in high school, and they knew about complex numbers and the relation with sine and cosine, so he explained it to me from his notebook. So also that there was those Schaum series books about various things. So some of those volumes I bought, and I knew certain things from like about advanced calculus and some other.
So these were essentially the first books, mathematical books that you studied. And more generally, what was your relation with books in your childhood? Were you reading a lot and mostly mathematical books or books of other types as well?
This I don't remember. There were books of other. No, I remember. I certainly there were many books of other kinds. Of course, it was not. It was not like now, where there are a lot of sources of information at that time. So, but I don't have those books anymore. I don't remember. But certainly, there were books also about science in general, like about the inventions and like there was one book telling about people who invented, I don't know if it was a book or part of a book, who rediscovered things, like some guy in the 19th century, some Russian old man who figured out calculus, and then he saw someone and told him that this is not a book, that actually it was invented by Leibniz and Newton, and then he thought about it, and then he died on his own. Anyway, there were some stories about this, of course, about all the inventions, like the steam engine and so on. I mean, it's kind of, I don't remember now the, but there were other books about stories on, not about,
but fiction maybe not so much.
No, there were some fiction or, I remember that I,
And today, what is your relation with books? Do you read a lot, or?
But now, because of the internet, it becomes atomized into looking at things on the web, and not it's difficult to reconstruct what one. But I also have many books, and I read some parts of them as they are. So I sometimes it used to be that I went to bookstores, and if there was some book that had some part that kind of is attractive, I would buy it and. And it was not only about, it was on many subjects, but usually not about fiction. There are several fiction things, but not necessarily. But certainly I did read some fiction. And there were books of Amos Oz, an Israeli author, and I read some. And my mother sent me one of them when I was at Harvard, like My Michael. But I read other ones, and there was other book that.
But anyway, if we come back to mathematical books, in retrospect, which mathematical book was most influential, that marked you the most among the first books that you read? What is the first, the most important book that that you read?
This is not.
Was in algebra?
No, so also when I took the exams for the first year of university without attending the courses, but by speaking with the professor, and there were several books that in particular from the library that
you couldn't single out.
No, there were several such books like about the courses in the university, like about algebra and I remember the author, some of them were in Hebrew, like people like like some guy called Meisler wrote on calculus and someone on forgot now the author on, but then there was a book of Rotman on group theory that I read at that time. Well, I read, I mean, looked at certain things, but I knew enough to pass the exams. Okay. So and I read also about some analysis things. I don't remember now. I remember at first it was not clear that I would be interested in algebra. I was also interested in things in other, And so Professor Wernick in particular sent me the treatise of Hobson on functions of real variables written in the 20s, and I did started to study things from there, and it helped me to know certain things in the courses in university, like the Riis-Fisher theorem, people were impressed that I knew the name because like I am more, okay. But this is just the beginning. But what influenced me, when I was a student in Tel Aviv University, I attended more advanced lectures, in particular by Moshe Zon, who taught algebraic geometry, and then Mari or Malka Schaps about algebraic topology, and then also Gottlieb algebraic topology, and Professor Sternberg on related to his book on Sternberg and Guillemin. So actually, those advanced things were very important for for shaping my interests. Mm-hmm. And then I was invited to Harvard, but the books are kind of
that.
More.
Yeah, we'll come to that.
Yes, it was not.
Yeah. So a different question. Gottendieck said that when, as a child, he discovered the circle, and he was fascinated by its beauty and also the extreme simplicity of its definition.
Yes.
So is there a geometrical or algebraic object that you discovered? Have you had a similar experience with something which you found so beautiful and inspiring, or perhaps not?
No, it was not like this.
You mentioned the seven bridges problem.
No, but this is not. No, it is.
But. And then geometry, for example, Euclidean geometry, did you find a special interesting figure or in algebra or something that fascinated you?
I don't know. I remember I had a grandfather who was a teacher of how to, I don't know how you say it in English. He was inspector of teaching how to do manual things. Anyway, but it was, he also knew some geometry. So I asked him like how to construct a regular pentagon. And then at some point I read in this book that I mentioned before about differential integral calculus. And I asked him what it is. And he didn't quite answer me because he thought I'm too young to understand. But this is, I don't know if I answered the question.
Yeah, I think it's fine. So when did you decide to be a professional mathematician? Was it very early or at a later stage when you were at Harvard or even before?
No, at Harvard I already.
You had already decided?
Yeah, yes, but before, I think already I took those advanced courses for, it was already in math mainly, and it was not in, So my mother recounts that I stopped my piano lessons. I took from about age 7 to age 10. I don't remember the age, and I stopped them because I thought that I want to do math instead. And so, but I cannot tell you the exact date.
Okay.
But still, certainly I learned for 3 years, and then I was more interested in thinking about math. But
yes. When did you discover Bourbaki and EGA? And how did you assimilate Bourbaki and EGA?
No, but when I studied the courses at Harvard, so it was, I looked at Gottendieck, so this is maybe not in the, in the first year, I certainly studied things like I remember, like Hartshorne's residues in duality, it looks like, and then Altman-Kleinmann.
But it's already very advanced.
But I didn't start from EGA. I didn't start.
Already you have Bourbaki, EGA.
No, I didn't start from EGA. The point is that there were courses like Hironaka. Hironaka said in his course that the EGA is like a dictionary, no one reads a dictionary. So, but still I needed, for example, writing the things for my thesis, I needed to references. So I used to make on sheets of paper a list of small remarks and go to the library and verify the references like EGA such and such. So I certainly used this system of EGNs, as he references quite well, mm-hmm. when in the fourth year I already looked at various things, like even what you wrote on perfect complexes, I used in some place in my thesis. This was a late stage. I found it out, and then it was very convenient for me to use. And there were things on, like the, you know, algebraic geometry, like the paper of Elkik on Enzelian things. So I used, maybe the end of my third year, I remember I was working on one chapter in my thesis, and I went by bus to the library in Bar-Ilan to find this paper and to figure out the reference. It was some theorem on page 568, and just I put this. The Bourbaki and EGA was not the primary thing. The point is that I went back to EGA.
I understand.
But
then my next question is that you looked into some passages, some chapters of Bourbaki or EGA, and then you read them carefully. Did you find any mistakes?
In
Bourbaki or in EGA?
In EGA several times I sent emails about various comments. And even in Bourbaki, in 1984, I sent a letter to Bourbaki, or two letters about some. Mm-hmm. But later on, I found several things, like in the part of monological algebra, there is some sign question. I don't remember now exactly, but it's okay. They have some. But in later times, okay. I found more. But
in inaccuracies.
In the community, in the new commutative algebra thing, and also in some exercise, and even in the old part on valuation, there was some strange exercise. Maybe they didn't think about what they were writing. It was, and sometimes it's not a mistake, but surprisingly, they didn't put certain facts like that. When you have like a rank one and zillion valuation, that the Galois group, when you complete, doesn't change. You don't put it explicitly, it is well known, and I had to use it in some places. So, in fact, I wrote down the proof in some places, but it was not there. But there were also some mistakes,
Did you keep a record of these mistakes?
No, those things are very scattered. They are not, sometimes it is in some emails, but sometimes or letters, but sometimes it's just not that I put on the margin in some copies or. Mm.
In 1981, you received the Erdős Prize.
Yes.
For outstanding results in algebraic geometry, algebra, graph theory, representation theory, and partial differential equations. But you had met Erdős earlier. In fact, it was in December 1973. You were 15 years old. And it was, I think, on the occasion of a lecture that Erdős gave at Tel Aviv University. You attended the lecture, and then afterwards you talked to him, and a correspondence followed. Do you remember what it was about?
No, but my mother found some documents in...
But do you remember the kind of topics? What was it?
Yeah, found some documents.
Discrete mathematics. Was it analysis? You have a vague remembrance of what it was about.
I remember that I wrote to him something about what I was interested in, but he sent me some problems. My mother kept some record. I mean, she found it in his file that his daughter found in his home after his death, and also some letters that he sent to me. Maybe they were kept in another place in the house, but now I don't remember. She told me some time ago that it was in his handwriting. Now I don't. There were elementary questions. I think she tried to send you a copy of some of those.
Yeah, but she didn't succeed.
Yeah,
actually.
So it's, I don't.
Okay.
It was like Putnam type questions. It was not. It was not. In any case, Erdős would never did things like the Grothendieck-style algebraic geometry. It's contrary to his taste. It was just things where you don't have a lot of theory, although he developed things in the directions of some subjects, like set theory, did advance some kind of complicated combinatorial things. And in fact, there are things, many things are named after him. He did analytic number theory, I think, but not the algebraic part side mm-hmm. that I...
But actually, that brings me to my next question. You have worked and you are a known expert in many domains of mathematics.
Yes.
Combinatorics, discrete math, analysis, representation theory. So why eventually did you choose algebraic geometry as your preferred working area? What especially attracted you there?
No, but I started already in my thesis to do algebraic geometry.
But why? Why? Why did you choose that? You might have proved very deep conjectures in partial differential equations.
Yes, but I did. So the partial differential equation part is just a subject of the minor thesis. It was given to me by Professor Sternberg. I was supposed to read a paper of Hormann there in 1978, and this was about the existence of wave operators in scattering theory, and I studied for some time and went to some libraries to find papers and books and so I succeeded to actually improve a certain technical thing with estimated for some 2/5, I don't remember. So this was, then I told it to Sternberg, actually this was not written. Later I wrote a letter to Hormann there about this fact, and he said, well, it is in my book on partial differential. He wrote, at the same time he wrote a new edition of his book, or in any case, around 1978 or 82. Well, the letter was in 82. So in any case, I discovered, so this is my contribution. Maybe they heard about it from Sternberg, but it was not the main subject, just the minor thesis, which also in France, they used to give such things for people who do test d'etat, but they had to do it orally. Yeah. And at Harvard, they had to actually write down something, but I didn't succeed to write it down. I wrote the introduction, Sternberg corrected me, and then I had some files of pages about this. I didn't succeed to complete in time because I also had to present my main thesis, and there were a lot of work at that time to type and so on. So it's now the other subjects, like I worked with Zvi Galil in Tel Aviv University, asked me some questions, but this was kind of not the main subject, just I solved some there is a famous paper which about superconcentrators, which it just uses elementary things.
But eventually...
it's not that I'm expert in a subject. I worked for some time, mm-hmm. and also in representation theory, I worked in the early 80s with Joseph and Victor Katz, so there are several papers. Then I continued, from time to time I returned to the subject, but I am not, of course the theory of perverse shifts is related to the Kasdan-Lustig conjecture and so on, so in this way I continued.
Mm-hmm. But you know, Grothendieck said that he shifted to algebraic geometry, arithmetic, because he has worked and did deep things in functional analysis. And then when he said that when he discovered the beauty of arithmetic geometry, that was a new world to him, a new landscape, and it was so much enjoyable. So in your case, I think you enjoyed many things, and maybe a slight preference for algebraic geometry, or a very big preference.
Yeah, so at first maybe, you see, the courses that I had in Tel Aviv, which were the most advanced ones, that were not part of the first degree, but they, like the algebraic geometry and topology and some. So I first thought they will do something related to this. But then at Harvard, the main emphasis was algebraic geometry because, of course, they had, at that time, they were the world center in algebraic geometry with Hironaka, Mumford, Griffiths. Of course, there was also Mazur, an advisor was in number theory. So, and Kasdan came there, and he gave a seminar on Drinfeld work in the end of my second year, maybe, and then in his office, which was also full of religious books, he was also a religious Jew. Then there were questions about the talc homology. The Drinfeld considered in a special case, some by hand constructed talc homology for rigid analytic varieties. At that time, I also went to a course of Artin on the talc homology at MIT with all the fundamental things. So, I found, so while waiting for a bus from Artin's course, I had this idea on the Grothendieck question on the Brouwer group, how to solve it. And so this was one of the chapters in my thesis. So at that time, of course, the Brouwer group gives you H2, and then you can try to. But then I found out that, like, analyzing what happens in rigid analytic variety, you try by hand to calculate, so knowing about H2, some of the exact sequences that appear, some of them can be used in rigid analysis, you can try to make sense. So I worked, of course, it was working by hand without trying to define by hand what the tidal morphism. There were no, of course, the papers of Renaud didn't appear at the time. So I had to prove by hand all kind of basic scene. I think I succeeded to do some, at least some basic things, at least. But this was, so in any case, my interest in tidal cohomology comes from that time. But then it was easier to work on things like the Brouwer group. So I wrote I had another result about purity in dimension three. So this was my thesis. And then I was interested in, of course, the question of cohomological purity. I found a way by blowing up to doing dimension two. So this was something that from time to time I looked, for example, at this expose of Artin in SJ419. We had some rather non-trivial, tricky arguments about in characteristic zero doing the affine cohomological dimension. I sorted it from time to time. Finally, it inspired me to find the results of my work that in 2005 about the. So in any case, the question of algebraic geometry from that time, 1976, about the tidal cohomology, this was the important thing that I returned to. So I was mainly interested for some period. It was of course without ideas one cannot work on it, but still it's.
I was to ask you later about what is your most memorable experience in math, but I guess that perhaps the discovery on Brouwer is among the most memorable experiences.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
So now the different type question. If you look at living and dead mathematicians, which one you think has marked or influenced you most?
No, you see, I discussed with many people at different periods, so it kind of changes. The emphasis is on when and where, and so it's and the subject changes because. I think that it's very. I never met Grothendieck, of course. I just knew from reading, but certainly the professor at Harvard influenced me. But there was many of them. Also, Maser himself gave something, and I did something like I observed that using a kind of property on their own model that the C. They had this.
So Grothendieck was influential.
Yes. No, I observed things.
Yeah,
related.
But sometimes the people just mentioned.
But you cut me. You cut me in. I said about Maser that he gave some course or something about elliptic curves and L functions. In any case, I observed that this Manin constant is integral, and in fact, people know about it because I told. There are influences, I'm saying, from several professors at Harvard and several colleagues. Then in Israel, there were less. But then I came to the IHES, and there were several people that, like Katz and Friedland there I was. And then there were courses, like in 82, Suslin gave a course on Mercury of Suslin. This was part of what I did, was very influenced by Suslin. And those people in the K3 seminar at that time. So they're different. For every subject, there are different influence. And so, for example, Thomason came in the late 80s, early 90s, and then I was reading his paper and found a way to apply what he did for purity in tidal cohomology in 1992, and I talked about in 94. So this, but this influenced just this part, this period. So it's not. And then I cannot say.
I hope I'm not cutting you, but you said you didn't meet Grothendieck, of course, but I think you met Serre, right?
Yeah, Serge was there. I went to his courses.
Yes.
Many times.
Yes.
So most of his courses in since I was in the IHES in 82. So in the spring of 82, and then.
And how would you describe these courses? And was it influential? Was it important, or just?
Yeah, but this was kind of important for the community that did algebraic geometry and number theory, because Serge was also giving some in the beginning of the talk. He was giving some survey of the seminars this week, so everyone had to be. And to go there to be informed of the right thing and to speak with the others and so on. So
the social event.
Yeah, so it was, it was, one could not miss this. This. And of course, he stopped just when Weyl's did the Fermat-Last theorem, he stopped. He didn't give a course on Fermat-Last theorem. Mm-hmm. Maybe people didn't know quite. In any case, he I think in 93 gave the. Yes. So I followed most of the courses except. I found that I don't have the course from 85, 86. I don't know if he gave it in Paris or in another place, but it's. And so also Tietz. I went to Tietz a few times. I went to Alan Cohn. And.
How about Deligne?
Okay, I didn't mean. Of course, it was very important, but he was at IHS just. I met him in 1980.
Yeah, there was a small, small intersection.
Yeah, there was, no, but certainly he told me about Weyl 2 in 1980, and then I found, a few days after, I found the proof of the purity of intersection cohomology using the stuff that he did in Weyl 2, and this was in July 1980. And then, of course, there were many discussions at lunch about things, so I have some of the, still some pieces of papers from lunch, but it was also discussing with many other people. But he used to, so there was a lot of information, but now I don't remember vividly all the, he left, I think, in 84, and I came to. But he was the one that because of him I was invited to the IGS in the first place, or my visit was extended gradually, and then I became a CNRS visitor, or a long-term visitor, as it was called. So, yes, I think he was, but I'm saying it is only for this result plus some related things on the monodromy filtration and other commuting arbitraries. There are several things that I did in 81, I told him. And of course, I told him when he was at Harvard, I met with him and I told him about what I can do in the tal cohomology at that time. So I remember this was, but I. I somehow work each time there were people like Katz that continued to come to the IHES many times, and I discussed with them often, I mean, much more because of the many years
Deligne didn't come back so often.
Yeah, right? He came back in 85 and he didn't. But when it was a few years in the early 80s, I did discuss a lot, I mean, quite.
But afterwards, did you keep a correspondence with him, or just at some places, just from time to time, not a regular correspondence?
No, there was no. Not he so tried much. To invite me to the Prince. This was in the 80s. Then I did not. There was no, essentially very little. I have some file about it. Of course, there are some things, but it's just that, and of course, I came there in 2000, and I don't remember if it was, I have a file with various things, but it's not, doesn't mean it's not about, it's about inviting me to, about going to Princeton. Mm. Then there was one point, at one point I sent him an email about his work related to what Drinfield did. I mean, this paper he wrote around 2012, and he finally sent me to after some time what he wrote, but it was, I don't remember that there was a lot of email, maybe, and of course I gave a talk in his conference, at the conference in his honor, but the other people in, so I, actually there was, and of course I have some letters, like when he visited here, he wrote me by some letter in 2013 about some questions, so there are some documents, but it's not really a big...
May we change topics for a little while, and may I ask you a question?
What did you start to say?
Change topics
for a little while,
and may I ask you some questions of maybe a philosophical nature? So, when you do mathematics, what is your feeling? Do you think you are discovering things, or you are constructing things? So there are some people who have very strong thoughts about that. I don't invent, I don't construct, I just discover what is God-given somehow.
No, but certainly there is in the presentation and the way there are many variants of doing something. Like you can do algebraic geometry in the Weyl language, or the Serre or Grothendieck, and then you can then do some foundations in a more advanced way, like you can do old-fashioned category theory, use some people who do infinity categories now. So of course, I think that some of it is the style of different people. It's not really, there could be a huge realm of possibilities, and we only use a small part of it for various reasons, in particular because it would be take too much time to exploit all of them. But there are many possibilities to present certain things in different styles, and it can look different or depend on people's education and so on. So there are some people who used Weyl-style algebraic geometry because they were not comfortable with Skinner, but now like people who use Grothendieck style, sometimes they are confronted with people who work now using much more elaborate machinery.
But I understand that there are several ways of describing the mathematical objects. But do you think you are maybe a builder? You construct things, or you discover things which are
No, certainly I discover properties. Well, there is a question whether there is an objective mathematical reality in nature, but we know from logic that some questions are not decidable, like the continuum hypothesis. Is it really true or false in nature? That could be different opinions. And whether, what about the set of all sets? If the sets exist, then why the set of all sets doesn't exist? So we have to avoid such questions, just work on certain things, like if we work on like analytic number theory, we don't have to worry about the set of all sets. But still, for the philosophical question of whether the mathematical object really exists in nature, I'm not sure. You certainly discover properties of the integers, like when you have the law of quadratic reciprocity, or when the Greeks discovered the Pythagoras theorem, or any other things that they did. It suddenly discovered things. I mean, clearly, those geometrical things somehow exist in nature, at least the usual nature. And then also many other concrete things about various functions. Certainly, the Riemann zeta function is.
So you discover properties
of the Riemann zeta function. On the other hand, if you construct some theory of, let us say, model categories for doing some homotopy theory in some context, and you have different people that have different versions. The question is if they invent it or discover it. But, well, they decide to put some axiom that some category has finite limits or collimits, and some guy can say, well, we don't need it, we have a weaker one. So do we really invent it or discover? So I'm not sure. I think that you work on some formalism, and there are different ways to do like higher categories. Are they invented or discovered? Of course, it's related to other people kind of compete with each other, so they like things to be different, but even if they are the same, sometimes sometimes things which are different are considered for some reason to be the same, sometimes they are the same, they are considered to be different, and now, there is no, but I think that some fundamental things are discovered, but there are some formal theories which are more like invented, and there are different ways to do it. But in some sense, they are also discovered because maybe all those ways are written in some book, and you have to.
This question of inventing, discovering, constructing is also linked with the very good question, philosophical question, the nature of mathematical objects. So, roughly speaking, there are two viewpoints, right? The Platonic and the materialistic. So, what is your view? Is it both or one of them? So, the Platonic view is that mathematical objects exist independently of any physics,
yes.
And independent of Big Bang,
yes.
Independent of anything, and others would say, well, no, the mathematical objects in fact exist in the brain of mathematicians, for example, in your brain, or in the books, in the libraries, in the electronic documents. So it's just atoms or gluons or whatnot. So what is your view?
Well, there is some consistency because we know that the theorems that are proved correctly are. Sometimes you have other proofs, but you don't find contradictions unless someone makes mistake. So this holds for the main body of mathematics, although there are some cases where there are some obscure points. But and this, at least for centuries, this it continues to be built in some. With some consistency and to be applied to physics and so on. So this doesn't mean that the Platonic viewpoint can be accepted completely because of the logical problems about like set theory that I mentioned, like if you believe that sets exist, then what about the set of all sets? And so on. You may need, in the usual foundation, we need set theory. But there are people who worked on different versions of the foundations. Of course, you can just restrict set theory to like in type theory of Russell and White, that just you have natural numbers, power sets, and power of power sets. Then you can just ask whether this really exists in some Platonic sense. In particular, then this would mean that the continuum hypothesis is either true or false in some Platonic world, and then you can have different views whether it makes sense. You can find in the literature some views, and there are people who write some books on philosophy of math, but I think that those kind of debates are really very usually relevant to what mathematicians do because the problems that they face have to do with more the content and the sociology of certain domains where the foundational things like this are not important relative to the huge amount of variance in the methods and the details that you have to study. You cannot even study deeply all the possible approaches in different subjects. But on the other hand, you can find material about the philosophical viewpoint. And in fact, there is more than two possibilities. There are more than two possibilities, I think. I cannot cite properly the authors that wrote about it. I don't have the language. I don't remember the language and content of those discussions. But there are some authors that looked at it. It's just not really, I don't think it's really so relevant, but certainly there is a viewpoint, the formal viewpoint, but I'm not completely in favor of this because there are certain things that you do, like when you discuss, for example, working with different kind of functions, like you have in different domains of mathematics, like you have continuous differential algebraic geometry, but then you have like analytic geometry of different kinds, and you have different kind of functions like over convergence and so on. Now, when you have functions, you can compose, multiply, add, differentiate, but you don't specify exactly the situations in which this is possible. Sometimes you can discover a new kind of functions, like you have rigid analytic geometry. Now there are different ways to do it, but you can find slightly different type of rings. Let us say you have overconvergent, and then maybe some other. Anyway, we know that certain things develop in stages. Like you have different kind of Fontaine rings with different kind of overconvergence. So before certain things were discovered, you cannot really make a list of all the possibilities. But still, you can say that some manipulations. Like I had some experience in working some version of Elkick approximation. You can make some proof with certain that should work for different classes of functions, but you cannot explain formally to a computer what you mean by this kind of intuitive operational knowledge or skill. I mean, you cannot, it's not completely formal in the sense you can give it to a computer. The people who do formal proof, some of think about computer verifying the proof, but human thinkers can have some idea, like having some function and operating with them, and they can see that it works in different contexts, like in differentiable or with certain conditions. Of course, you have to verify that you can do certain things, but it's not possible to formalize this kind of thinking, which is natural for people, and even can use it in proofs by saying that it's clear that how to do something. So in fact, the proof is not really formal. It just uses some kind of human abilities which are not formalized. And so this is, this is about not whether a mathematical object exists, but I'm still, but anyway, there is this view, formalist viewpoint that you just deduce assertions like in Zermelo-Frankel system, but still it is not a complete representation of all mathematics because you can do things which are like, studying other systems, or it's not. So in fact, people think that there is no. So I've seen some paper of what is his name? There was this Husserl, maybe he wrote in some.
Husserl is a historian.
He did some algebraic and analytic geometry, but he wrote somewhere that there are no complete foundations of mathematics in some place. Anyway, I'm not, so you cannot have a
straight division, it's more complex, yes. Yeah, situation is more complex than just the dichotomy between.
It is also possible that because knowledge expands in different subjects, we don't know what will happen. Like we see, like in the archive, the number of papers grows exponentially. Maybe at some point, it will be so complicated that the mathematicians could not agree between themselves about what is true. and then there will be different, it will not be one subject, but just because of limitation on ability to, and even now, there are subjects where some parts are not so clear or not.
I see. So that leads me to a question which is somehow related. When you do mathematics, how do you work? You see, there are people who think about mathematics while walking, people who think about mathematics, and there are. In bed, for example, close eyes and think of things. And people like Grothendieck, who was at his table and taking notes, writing. So how do you do mathematics? Do you walk? Do you take notes?
No, it helps, it helps to walk to remember certain things. But I now a lot of the work, because of the technique that uses computers, like I answer email or work with some people or write some comments, but then this can take most of the time because I split the task to smaller ones, and then I have to check references and so on. So then most of the time is just devoted to actual, if I want to work, then I have some tasks that I didn't complete. So in fact, now I'm just working on writing emails and stuff like this. I'm not working on what I wanted to do.
We'll come to this email question later. But suppose you don't have all these tasks, you want to just to do mathematics, to think. So, what is your preferred way? You just walk and think.
I walk. No, but sometimes I have ideas, and I used to write them. on briefly or not, so on some. So in older times, I wrote more to myself in this way, but then it became influenced by the technology. So now sometimes I write to people some emails or scans and so on. Then I write to myself, but it is in some notebook or in the margin of some. Then it is difficult to collect all the information because it is done in different times. And I cannot remember what I did on the same thing. Sometimes I can reconstruct and sometimes not. So it, so things are, because as time progresses, things are more atomized and difficult to reconstruct. And then I can still work like. So before I give a talk, I have some notes and I work out various many details and. It's but it's usually there is some idea how to do solve something at some point, like this, like recently on this question of weak functoriality of weak Kolmogorov algebras and commutative algebras. So I found some blowing up observation that anyway, while walking or why, so this kind of is. Was again, it allowed me to give this, to propose them to give a talk. In fact, I already told them that I will give this talk before. Anyway, I found something that was used in my talk in Berkeley and so on. So there is some inspiration. But then you have to read things and think about different. As I said, most of the time, because I work with various people just to correct and I delay something, so then if I want to go back to some joint papers and work on them, then it will take all the time just to work on different versions and so on. So it's really because of this practical thing, it's kind of not the. But I. Also, it changes with time. It's really because of different subjects at different time, and each time it's not really the same method, the same circumstances, the same technology, the same people, and the same means of communication, the same. Sometimes the subject was simpler, like when there were only the papers of Thomasson on algebraic K-theory, so there are two main papers. It was much, much, much easier than today, where you cannot really read all the. But still, there are people who manage to work on the now. On the, but I don't know exactly what they do because I know the.
So people from all around the world write you to consult to ask you questions and. You are very scrupulous. You answer everybody and with a very precise answer. And usually it comes in 400 scanned documents.
Yes.
And I observe that there are no crossing out. There is just a very neat or very few crossings out. So do you make a first draft or does it come all armed in your from your brain somehow? It's already in your brain and you just write and it flows naturally.
It depends on the case because sometimes I simplify it and so that I can write. We already thought about something and I kind of simplify the. As usual, you skip some difficult technical thing. I mean, you kind of discuss it more informally and you can communicate the main idea in two or three pages and then you can send it. So. It's kind of more attractive to do it because the other one will get it fast, and so but sometimes I have some, I don't succeed to work on something in time. Sometimes I come back to it, and sometimes I write. So sometimes I have to draft, also in emails, in some long emails, sometimes I used to work for days or even more on some email and make some changes and. I had some computer problems, I got some assistance. Then in more recent years I use scans because it's more, but I remember that I worked with There were two long emails in 2007-2008 related to pseudo-reductive groups, to Brian Conrad, and those were important for my work. And I did work for a long time on those emails. I mean, it was maybe a long time, means not just one day, but it was after.
So with the many revisions.
Yeah, there were many changes. And so I was printing out and correcting things. And so usually I did this for then. There were other things like, well, there are different questions. Some things that I did, like comments on SGA3, it was also with emails or scans.
But do you think you devote maybe now that you devote too much time to this? Tasks, answering emails, or you
well,
would like
actually,
to have more time for yourself? And
no,
just,
no, but you see, the point is, actually, you count the number of emails, you see, it's not so much in a week or so, it's not that I write every day, and less than one, it's not, there are people who maybe write many emails every day, but maybe not in business, or I don't know in. But I, so the point is that certain things can look simple, but because of the time management, delaying various things, sometimes there is a conference, there is this to do, this to do. So what happens is that I somehow can fill the day without doing much. And still I can fill it with various things. Then the next day is the same and so on, and then it gets delayed and there are other questions. And then I cannot, you see, so in fact I don't do enough of this. I think that I could maybe be more efficient because I already know the ideas. So if I have two or three things that I know the ideas, I could just, but it's not like this. So it's, yes. But sometimes it's like this and then it is what you said, that I write those things without mistake, but sometimes it's not. And then, okay, it's
yes.
It depends on the time, and then I there is some psychological processes that are all the time kind of which input I get, and this if it is about the same subject or not. And
but
and
in, I think in, maybe I can sum up that saying that still you enjoy it. You enjoy answering.
No, but sometimes it contributes to my own work.
Yes.
Or it's about joint works with other people and so on. So it's really,
But that brings me to the next question. So you have helped and still are helping many people, many students and young students. For example, I remember that group de travail, that seminar on your work
yes.
in the 2006 and up 2010 and a little
2008.
Yeah, 2008, yes. And so in you have helped older students like myself, for example. So have you ever considered teaching? Because you're very gentle with students, and I think you enjoy it, and also the students enjoy it immensely.
but this is just you look at isolated circumstances. As I said, it's not regular teaching for a semester and so on. And then it will. I don't see how I can teach and at the same time work. Like, for example, when I worked with Romero on this very long project, it got complicated because of Scholz's work. So I cannot work on teaching at the same time, or I cannot work seriously with, like, if it's every other day, then I can maybe answer some other emails. Like, the thing that I did in the other time, but I cannot, maybe for teaching, it will take me, depends what kind of teaching. What I do is just seminars on what I do from time to time. I did teach in Tel Aviv University a little bit advanced things, but somehow it didn't turn up, did not succeed so well. I mean, it was algebraic, like algebraic geometry following Archangsburg, but then there were some formal thing about shift theory that I tried to do, and then it was too slow and the student didn't like it. They wanted me to explain about the Talc homology or, well, I don't know the It was so I think that you need to have a good balance. I mean, to know how to teach is different than to know to actually interact in seminars and also the subjects change. Even if I want to teach advanced things, then those things change rather rapidly. So I cannot teach. I mean, if I don't know certain things now, well enough, I cannot. Well, I can teach some things, but not.
Anyway, you enjoyed being at CNRS,
yes.
I guess. And so it's a question, why did you choose CNRS? Did you choose to stay in France? So you might have been invited to many places, first in Israel and then in the States and many places. So why did you choose to stay
in France? I'm not so sure, because when I was here, it was natural that they proposed me in 1984 to apply to the CNRS. And as I said, I was all the time busy with small things, with going to the seminars and writing letters. At that time, it was in handwritten form, and like to remarks on some other people's papers and so, or other things. But in any case, I was, since I had all the documents here, kind of complicated to move, because that, if you have a lot of paper documents, part of them are still in Israel, and it's kind of not very attractive. I don't think that there were actually any formal, because offered in any case, if I don't want to teach, there were not so many possibilities. It's only CNRS, or maybe the Weizmann Institute in Israel, or yes, but I don't think they would. I'm not so sure there was really real options except for the CNRS, essentially. In any case, I made this application, and I was given a post rouge in 1984. And actually, a year later, I was given a permanent position. But actually, my salary in the first year was higher than the one, because in the CNRS they start in a low level. And then I gradually got one, but it is, it's kind of a, so at the first years, the CNRS was not kind of very liberal. One formally had to write some reports, but they didn't care much about it. And then later, they become more and more demanding, and it became more complicated. But still, I got my promotion to DR2 in 95, when it was still relatively easy. I could write something by hand. And it was not, took one day or so, and was typing a few things, and then, for DR1, I needed a lot of help to do this. It is
so more paperwork.
Yes, and of course, now I was told that to get DR2, you need habilitation and so on. You need much more work to do the same degree.
Yeah,
the same.
Things are changing, you
yes.
know. Just leaving the École Normale, I was admitted at CNRS. I had done nothing, you see, just so, so things have changed a lot.
Yeah.
Anyway, a different question. Maybe I'm not sure you will like it. Have you ever made a mathematical mistake? Because you know, people know that you are such a high level.
No, no, but there are mistakes, and there are even embarrassing mistakes, like the in my paper with Gog, of course, a small mistake, like in the proof of the Cohen-Gabber theorem.
Uh-huh.
There is a small commutative algebra stupid thing, and it is repeated in the volume of the asterisk as if without. The point is that because of time pressure, I did not check things which I already know, and even with other things, there were still a few mistakes. So. But this maybe can be blamed on.
Yes, and can
Still, on the original paper, there was a mistake, and in other, like John Pedro with some Indian people, there was some. I had a version, and actually there was some remark about curves, like it was about the index. What was it? The Brouwer obstruction for. About the modular space of stable vector banner. Anyway, there is some remark about the case of genus 2, which is actually not correct in one case. So, and I don't know how I. So there is a mistake that I did not. Someone wrote. So usually, what the theorems that I claim are correct, but one point, Colliotti-Len wrote in one of his papers in the early 90s that I announced the proof of purity for the Brouwer group, and in fact it was not correct. There was no such proof. And even I was supposed to talk in the seminar, and then I changed the last moment. I sent the subject to something that I could prove, and later I published even a note in mm-hmm. in about this note on the Brauer of impurity. That's just based on this lecture, which is easy to write down. Then later I gave a talk in Oberwolfach about the in 2004 about the results that I could prove. So recently, Cesnavicius, a young mathematician, solved the problem using perfectoids. And so anyway, this was not on my name, but someone said that I could prove something. In fact, I could not prove. But usually, it's as I said, there are some misprints or some mathematical mistakes in some places. It's not
Formal proof checking by computer has recently made some progress, considerable or not. I'm not so sure, but some progress. So do you think that one day a computer program can replace Gabor's certification of signs in homological algebra? When you certify that this diagram has a minus sign or commutativity, then people believe you and that's
No,
the
this
end.
I did a long time ago.
No, computer
you
can,
see,
can do better.
I did it with Brian Conrad in the book on residues in duality. No, on Grothendieck duality and phase change, which was based on reading Archon residues in duality and correcting, particularly the sign questions. And he didn't quite understand what I told him, but finally he wrote some compliment or errata to the book that explained the sign. Then there was a sign in Takeshi Saito paper in 2003 about spectral sequence for vanishings. I forgot what it was. Anyway, it dates for some time. And then, more recently, I didn't have the time to go into the sign that August and his student were looking at. They explained to me August
Picard and Lefschetz, I think.
And yeah, also,
some,
yeah,
some
yeah.
new proof of Picard Lefschetz.
Yeah, by you, yes.
Yes.
But
yeah.
there was also. Oh, there is
a new one by also by August, maybe. And,
and new one?
Student. I think August worked on Picard Lefschetz recently, right?
Yeah, but there was, I'm speaking, they asked me in recent years and I was not able to go into it. So in fact, this idea about checking sign, it goes back to the maybe early 2000 and so there were not so many cases of this and I know the basic, I know a system of conventions that I used to think about, so I could, it becomes more and more complicated because the objects themselves which are studied are more complicated. And so one cannot really make sense of, I mean, if you use some very fancy things with all kind of motivic things that people now do, that all kind of things go into the definition, you cannot really check in the same way without knowing the like mm-hmm. if it has to do with Voivodsky motives and different. Mm-hmm. I'm not really sure, but I think that the thing of August and Aschinger is more classical thing, but mm-hmm. you have to think a lot on his. Mm. And I did succeed to send him some remarks on his log geometry book, but some of it came too late because he was for his book. I mean,
but
so the sign thing is not. I think that if you want a computer to do it, you have to put too many, because the texts are not formal, so you have to somehow manage some knowledge which is not completely formalized and get meaningful comments on. So I don't think a computer, as I explained, a computer can work very blindly and not, it cannot use intelligent analogies and so on between situations if.
So six operations in Ital cohomology and the signs which occur there, you think maybe it's too remote to put enough data in a computer to.
No, but people have succeeded to actually have formal proofs of different results. But the point is that they also use different systems. There was the question is now, if you do it in one system, can you go to another one? In fact, the system is not equivalent in the proof power. And then, how do you know that what the computer does corresponds to the problem that you want to solve intuitively. Mm-hmm. So you have to check. This is how do you really check that you formulate kind of the... So you have some problem, like you have actual papers that people wrote now several decades ago, which are not completely formalized, but then you have to translate it to some formal thing the computer will give you some information on the sign. But how do you know that what you give to the computer is really a representation of the problem? You can just, maybe someone could just put something that tells the computer to give a certain answer. I mean, you need some way to check that you don't cheat when putting, I mean, and this, you see, for this, you need the question to formalize this, but then you have an infinite chain, because if you formalize this, and you have a computer working and proving that this is, then that you didn't cheat, then how do you know you don't cheat in this? Then you have kind of an infinite transfinite layer, so yes. You cannot really, it's difficult philosophically to understand how you really formalize things, because somehow you have some people who work on this. Mm. And of course you can think that because they have some pressure to have results and so on because of grants and promotion and so on, so maybe they kind of hide some things. Okay, and then you have to check that they don't, when they tell you in some language you don't understand what they do, maybe they are hiding some subtleties. So how do you really check it? Because you always, so you have this thing in, they speak to you about things you don't really know. If you have to know it, then you will not have time maybe to study your subject. So you need to trust someone. If you need to, I mean, if you don't trust, then you cannot. So it's not clear. Some people think that having a human understandable proof is the best and kind of where.
I would say that the Gaber certified proof is the best.
Yes.
Anyway, you proved many conjectures, important conjectures, and you also suggested many problems and developments and posed many questions. But is there any specific conjecture of yours or hope that you would very much like to be proven or fulfilled? Is there any special? Result, conjecture that you would like to be to see proven.
Maybe I don't want to go to very recent things. You see, I gave talks in recent years. Some of it was not yet written about proving certain things. I think I can also prove some of what I conjectured, like related to this work of Cesnovici that I mentioned, but I know that they also work on this, so I'm not, anyway, I have some methods to, sometimes to answer partially or certain questions, or sometimes I succeed in I sometimes have complicated plans how to prove certain things. Like in periodic Hodge theory, it was based on, of course, Faltings purity, but in the special case of nice things. Then there was thing about cohomology of O plus in nice cases that could prove vanishing. I mean, this is not written, but it's some part of the discussion in my book with Romero. So the idea was to combine this plus some special result in kind of logarithmic situation and some de Jong type alteration and to do Falting style. Of course, Scholz's work didn't exist yet and people have all kind of approaches and something complicated. So I thought I could make some progress by combining several pieces and I only wrote some part of this input and so, and then Scholz's work was, led to much faster progress and he did not, using it as a perfecto, so this approach still has some elements which could be still be interesting. So I'm saying that it is not that sometimes I have some ideas how to do certain things, sometimes I give talks on it or not, but it's not that I hope to prove something that I don't know. I mean, except that it used to be like before I could prove the all the problems of Italco homology, I hope that this, like looking at this paper of Artin, will allow me to prove some, but this was already accomplished. But now I don't have specific, you see, I know how to do, the point is that certain things that are not completely worked out, like about algebraic, extending the theory of pseudo-reductive groups, like doing certain things on the compactification and central extension, I have some idea how to do certain things comparing like formal extension of formal groups and algebraic groups. And in some sense, in fact, some of it is already announced in Ober-Wolfach mm-hmm. report and so on. So in some sense, I want to kind of work out some things that I did before, but it is not. And so there are some plausible things that one can, of course, there are always some new things which occur, and it's not really something completely open problem that I don't know how to attack. This is not a good idea.
Also, ongoing.
There are several ongoing projects, and then from time to time, I have new ideas on some of it, like what recently I talked on in Berkeley and so on. And then I continue like to.
So just incidentally, you have among the ongoing project, there's this long ongoing project with Ramiro.
Yes.
So how is it advancing? And,
okay, so now I think that it's turned into doing Andre's, so the idea to do Andre's perfected by Anker Lehmann is slightly more general integral, refined integral form. And then you have several applications in commutative algebra, so some of it will be maybe in the manuscript, like direct summing conjecture for log regular ring and some application. And then some maybe more sophisticated things like some derived variants. And so I'm not sure. So it depends on which time Romero wants to finish the manuscript. So it's the problem is that doing it, there are also things which are left over from before. Like before in the book, we had some condition M tilde is flat. Then we generalize it for doing in perfected geometry, maybe work with more general. So in any case, we have like checking that the thing, technically, the certain thing that we do, like work under condition B instead of M. Mm-hmm. So I'm not so sure if the part is already written, maybe one is to still complete it with certain things. So I don't know how much time it will take, but still in terms of there are some new, relatively new thing in commutative algebra. But then it since the work is quite, I mean, it takes him a long time. So I think,
but
I'm not sure.
You're not sure how long it will take.
No, I'm not sure because it can it can get into some, like there were several years just because of formalism of stacks and descent and so on that was kind of getting into.
Okay, so let me change topic. So, but still on conjectures. So it's about the Hodge and the Tate conjectures.
Yes.
So Grothendieck, I think, wrote someplace that he thought that they should be either both correct or both false.
Yes.
So we'd like to know what is your feeling about them.
No, so I think that the okay, this is related to question of logic that we alluded to before about incompleteness and so on. So in theory, it could be that some statements, some interesting statements are not provable in certain formal system. So the logician said that there is always maybe a stronger formal system that you can, in which you can decide. So it is not clear if maybe the Riemann hypothesis, some of the problems like the Hodge conjecture, maybe they are not decidable in the system that we use, and so we will never have, we will always do some implications, and so I think that But I believe, yes, in any case, I think that I tend to think that the Riemann hypothesis will be proved at some point. But for and it is possible also things like the Beer-Swinnert and Dirac conjecture, after some technology sufficiently advanced, probably people will be able to, because you have to work, and this is the most likely of the clay problems that could be, and the Riemann hypothesis is maybe less likely. Then the Hodge conjecture is maybe it's undecidable, or I don't know. And the Tate conjecture is related, but I don't know if I can place it. The point that some progress in special cases is there are some you see there are some also some surprising developments in motives and so on, like the recently proved conservativity conjecture and some other techniques related to it, maybe can lead to more. So somehow you will have some, and he uses some foliation and differential Galois, since it are not related to the problem, and so it's possible it's somehow there will, and it somehow it constructs algebraic cycles in this. This is Ayoub's work. I'm not familiar so much with it, but it seems that if you can construct non-trivial cycles in some context, maybe there is a hope to prove more. But I don't know. I think it's not. Also, the Hodge conjecture could even be not true, actually. So it's not just that I know that I think for the Beer-Swinnert and Dirac conjecture, everyone thinks it should be true. But for the Hodge conjecture, maybe.
How about the Grothendieck standard conjectures of Lefschetz type, for example?
Yes.
You have to construct the cycles. Of course, because as you mentioned in Ayoub's work, there are some mysterious algebraic cycles. Proving the conservativity conjecture. So do you think that someday it's possible? Do you believe in the Grothendieck's standard conjecture? I mean, those involving constructing non-trivial cycles.
But anyway, it's closely related to the Hodge conjecture in characteristic zero. So let us say, how could you prove them in characteristic P's? You see, then it gets into discussing some recent things.
To finish okay. on some more okay. more general question. So, what are your dearest mathematical dreams? The things that you would like to see proven, achieved. Independent of your own work or work of people around you, so what are your most your dearest dreams? So every mathematician has some dreams.
No, but you see, I now don't work on dreams. I work on things that I can do, like in this project on almost string theory perfectoids, different kinds of perfectoids, different kinds of rigid analytic formalism and applications to different kinds of problems that sometimes I lectured on in previous years, and so I want to develop those things that I did in previous years and different techniques, including like topos theoretic technique, like the oriented product, but now you have different kind of rigid analytic things, so you have to study different properties of toposes, but related to cohomology and maybe, okay, so you have different, I know the technique, in other words, I'm working for myself, I'm working on things that continue what I did, and I think there is a hope to succeed in some, and the point is that there are some people that work with more complicated techniques that I'm like topological Hochschild homology, other things I don't know, so it's, but there is, like when you work on questions in periodic orange theory, there is some room, a lot of room to do certain things, but it is like continuing previous threads. It's not, in, and so I don't, but I don't have any
because there was the Jugendtraum and there was a...
No, but this is not like this. Maybe I... no, but the question, I cannot answer the question. It is not, you said independently of my own work,
yes.
I cannot say exactly because I am... If you ask me about people who work on automorphic phones, what they cannot really...
Because you are not sufficiently implicated
in that. I think that
So for example, the successful completion of the Langlands program, but
No, it's really... but there are more and more sophisticated things like geometric Langlands. Really, it gets so complicated, like what Gates Curry does. I really don't know if it is my taste now to do those things because of this. You see, it depends on if I really want to study the machinery that he uses, then
it depends. Expanding.
If one lives long enough, then for several centuries, one can study all those subjects. But then there will be even more because there are other people that compete, so it grows exponentially. So if Gates Curry does those things now, and suppose you live for another 100 years, then even if you will be able to know what is done now, we will not be able to know what the, so it's not clear what will happen in mass, because really, it, no one will be able to know it's, So maybe actually some people think that it will, that somehow it will decay. I mean, some part of mathematics will, after enough time, will. I mean, humanity will not be able to manipulate them in and already, like the number of years is for graduate students, like maybe now in some places 5 years, it used to be 4 or 3, I don't know, so kind of become more and more difficult. Of course, you cannot expect people will study like 50 years, this is not possible. So at some point there would be, you can see that it cannot continue for a million years or so, I mean, how can... people know. So okay. I don't know. So maybe it's kind of a singularity in the human experience. There is some kind of, and after maybe people will be doing only things which are useful in technology or in, or maybe if finally if technology is sufficiently advanced, then some terrorist groups will be able to destroy mankind. So there is some limit to say, maybe we'll not...
maybe that's a good point to leave it here now, to stop. Thank you very much.